That makes me think about testing, and testing has been a challenge from the beginning of this crisis, and we've made some progress, and we've got scientists working around the clock trying to do what they can. Could you talk us through a little bit about the history of testing and where we are now and what some predictions could be for the future as well?
Indeed. There's this mantra that most public health officials and in the healthcare system generally folks have been repeating is that to deal with this disease, we need extensive testing, extensive contact tracing, and then isolation of those that are infected. It's been very hard to do. First of all, there are 7.5 billion people in the world, and you potentially, economically, financially, you couldn't test them all. But we probably could test more than the number of people that we are testing right now. So there's quite a bit of room there. The problem has been testing is not the same everywhere. I mean, the history of testing for this disease is fraught with many failures. Early tests were, first of all, a new test needed to be developed for this, and it took a while. Different countries developed the tests in their own way. In fact, healthcare institutions, they developed their own tests in their own way. And there was not a global coordination and sharing of insights and data on that, not as much as one would have liked. So that's been a big challenge. Add to that, the difficulty in gathering the samples, nasal swab has been the most dominant way, the primary way that samples have been collected for diagnosis of the disease. But how deep do you take the swab from, who does it? And this is not the only disease where sampling is a challenge. I mean, malaria is another one, right? Number of other diseases. But in this case, because it's such a widespread disease and so, so quickly moving, the sampling and how you gather the sample has been a challenge. Combine that with the challenge with the early tests, the data has not really been that credible early on. The third thing has been that it's a lot of these tests, at least the good tests that are that have been more accurate, the PCR tests, RT-PCR tests, those can only be done in a reference lab, in a laboratory setting. Those cannot be done at the point of care, which means that you got to collect the sample, you got to send the sample to the lab, and you have to actually then do the test and then report the results back. But there's a time lag, I mean, sometimes days, if not weeks. And that means that if a patient comes in and gets a test done and then goes home, and you don't have a way to trace that patient or track that patient, you could lose that patient. And during that time that you're doing the testing or the test results are waited, that patient could be interacting with others if the isolation is not followed. So that's been a challenge too. There have been a number of tests that, number of different ways of doing the tests that that have been put forward other than swabs. There have been some saliva tests and so on. And those have not really been proven to be as effective as the RT-PCR test. So that's made things more difficult. I think going forward, the diagnostic tests for, whether a patient is currently infected by, SARS-CoV-2 virus, this virus that causes COVID-19 disease. I think we have a good handle on it now, as long as we are using the gold standard RT-PCR tests. And I think the timelines have shrunk, and now we can do the tests in a much shorter period. There are some rapid tests that have been developed by the industry, but those are still not ready for prime time, I would say. But I think RT-PCR tests are good to go, and I think that you can rely on that data. There is another kind of test that has been in the news recently. These are serological tests, and these are more for the detection of antibodies amongst patients that may have been exposed to the virus. And that's where a lot of controversy is today. These tests actually take a drop of blood and very quickly tell us whether the patient has presence of antibodies or not. It's believed that if you have antibodies after exposure to this virus, that you might be immune to the disease or you may not be infectious or both, although that's not proven yet. We cannot assume that. And add to that this issue of these serological tests, these antibody tests, having a certain false positive rate. Because vast majority of the population has not been infected or has not been exposed to the infection, even small percentage of the patients positives or false positives can actually skew your assessment of what part of the population has been exposed to this virus can be problematic. And you definitely cannot use that to say you as an individual, Anurag, or Pia as an individual was infected before and is now free of that infection and now has antibodies. You just can't make that judgment. And as a result, you can't make use that to go back to work or interact with the rest of the population. So that's where most of our challenges are right now.